everyone, and welcome to our debate about Roman 2.1, the modern urban style woman in a spectacular cafeteria, and with the support of the Norwegian embassy, represented here by Her Excellency Tomé Drobík Vestberg and the National Museum of Contemporary Art. I thank them for this wonderful place, and with the support of the Italian Association and the Univers Publishing House. The main guest here is the Norwegian writer Hanne Ørstavik, the author of the book Love, published by Univers House in 2012 under the title Univers. And I must confess, I couldn't help to notice that the founding year of the publishing house is your fourth year. Yes, you have the same age.
Yes.
And I must say about this book, I read it before its launch at Gaudamus Book Fair back in 2012, and it was an impressive read to me, because it's about a mother and a son, and I'm a mother and I have a son, and it's tone and the writing style and the pace, the rhythm of the book was very tense. That's what I felt. And in the end, I really wanted to meet the person who, to meet the woman who wrote the book, because you put it here a very delicate issue about motherhood and about being a single mother, raising a boy, and thinking maybe that you as a woman, you can't give him the right milestones, or maybe the right package to be a man later in life, because you're just a woman and you couldn't know what he would feel about love, or maybe about a relationship with a woman later. And this became one of my favorite novels, but we will get back to it later. Here we have Daniela Kamrat from 1-to-1. It's an online community 2 decades old, right?
13.
Yeah. But your activity in online is
around that.
And we have Chris Simeon. It's a well-known writer and director and public person. And I might say influencer, because she wrote also a book called in translation, what we are saying each other when we are not talking. And it's also about love, but the love starts by inside. Last but not the less important guest in this evening is Andrea Roșca. I know her for long years as a business writer, a business journalist, and now she is the founder of Romanian Business Leaders Foundation. And I confess I don't know very much about your activity, but as I know you as a journalist, I think you do great things there. How was it to write about this relationship, which is one of the most important relationships in a person's life, mother to child?
I started to write the novel. This is my third. I've written 11. I published 11 novels in Norway, so this is the third novel that came out. So before I had written two other novels in Norway, so this was my third one. And I started to write Love, Lubira, when I just had a daughter. I just had a baby. And the two novels I had written before, they were about, you know, grown-up adults. There were no kids in those books. But having a child myself kind of threw me back into my own childhood and that vulnerability of being a child. But then I was also on the other side. I was a mother. And the kind of the emotion or kind of the question of, or the quest of this book was, I was standing there with my newborn child and I was asking myself, how can I be sure that she knows or really feels that she is loved? How can I be sure? Because it's so hard. I mean, it was just like, I didn't know how I could be sure of that. And also for me, that was also a question of throwing back into language, because you can say that, you know, you can say to a person, I love you. And it feels, you know, filled and health and the words are, you know, true. And then another person, or maybe even the same person, can come towards you and say, you know, I love you. And you just know that that's just a lie, that's just nothing, that's rubbish. There is nothing inside the words. The words are empty, and I think when is it filled? So I think this novel, I wrote it really with this kind of desperation towards kind of this, well, towards language, and when is there something, and how to know when there is something in it. And I think the more I kind of have lived, I think that love is really kind of one of the things in life that you just have to, you know, trust. It's so much about have faith. And I guess at that point I was really kind of very anxious as a new mother. So that was kind of my background for starting to write it. But it's also, you know, it's about the boy and a mother, so I also wrote it, I know, where I was thrown back into my own childhood. And I have two brothers, and the opening of this book in Norwegian goes like this. Så langt det bare går an. Se ut av vinduet på fjell og biler på sjøen. Snakke med folk fra fremme døren. Være sammen hele tiden. Aldri komme frem.
I don't know, maybe somebody should read that in Romania so we can hear it. But that was kind of... I had my other brother, that was his mission. To put the whole family into a car and just drive away. We could be together quick. Forever. So, if you could read it in
there. Cartea începe așa. Când am să mă îmbătrânesc, vom pleca o călătorie cu tren, cât mai departe cu putință. De la fereastra lui vom admira munți și orașe și ape. Vom cunoaște alți oameni din țări străine și vom fi împreună mereu. Și niciodată nu vom ajunge la destinație. This is like a promise for the book. Because the action ends in no destination. The reader can imagine every final of the book. That's why I felt.
Yeah, that's true. I'll just, you know, tell very shortly for the people who haven't read the book what it's about. It's about a single mother and her son. It takes place in one afternoon and evening and night, and it's early in January, and it's up north in Norway. It's very far, or somewhere in the world, but it's And it's very cold and it's a lot of snow. And it's dark. In the northern Norway, there is no sun in the wintertime, so it's really dark. And it's after work. So it's kind of, it's a book that takes place in the private zone, in the home, in the private life, in the family. So it's Jon, this boy, he's waiting for his mother to come home from work. She comes home from work, they eat sausages for dinner, and then she wants to go to the library, so she takes off to, she has a bath, and then she goes to the library. But the library is closed, so and then there's a fair, you know, amusement park, you know, traveling amusement park on the field, in the snow, beside the building where the library is. And then she goes there, and there, accidentally, she meets a man who works at the fair, and she spends the night with him. And she has totally forgotten that her son, the next day is the birthday of her son, and he is longing so much to, you know, to have an electric train. That's really what he's really dreaming of, having an electric train. And he knows that his mother can't afford, you know, a whole Märklin train set, but at least a locomotive or something to start the collection. So, and he also goes out in the night. So the book follows mother and son. So there's short sections with the new angle, and they're offering. So the reader all the time knows where both of them are, but they don't know where the other are. So the other is. So it's kind of this kind of odyssey through the night. The book follows them in this winter and cold silence. And their journey. So that's kind of the plot of the novel.
I'm just, you're a writer too, and
I have been doing interviews today, and I was asked, or there was some journalist who said that being a writer and, how is it possible in Norway to be a writer and a single mother? And I was just like, to me that has never been even an issue. I mean, that was just natural,
but how is it here? I mean, would that be natural to be a single mother and do what you do?
Nu cred că ține de cât de mentalitate.
Dacă
ne mutăm pe
mentality.
Dacă ne mutăm pe spațiu francofon pe care îl cunosc, acolo diferența nu există.
I write about France and there's not a difference.
Dacă ne mutăm peste ocean, în state, automat libertatea de gândire este cu totul alta. Cred că ține foarte mult de spațiu cultural, de educația pe care o primești, ca să te dezvolți. România este o țară tradiționalistă.
Romania is a traditionalist state.
O puternic tradiționalistă.
Strongly traditionalist.
Iar femeia contemporană, societatea contemporană,
and the contemporary woman, the contemporary society,
deși teoretic își găsește un loc, concret, practic, încă se luptă cu mentalitatea masculină ca să se impună și să-i fie cunoscută la loc.
Even though theoretically she has a place in the society, she still struggles with a masculine mentality to find her place in this society.
Și nu vorbesc numai de meseria mea, unde activez ca regizor sau ca scriitor, este vorba de
and I'm not only talking about my job as a writer, that's a common mentality here, this struggle.
It's interesting, there are so many layers in this topic, I find, that also, I don't want to take away your focus here, but I just wanted to say also that in the novel, in this novel, it's kind of, one thing is kind of the society and how if there is a good framework and support for single parents. But In this novel, the mother is, you know, she is capable. She is not a social case. She has a full-time job in the bureaucracy as a consultant in culture issues in the department of that local small community where they live. And she cooks for her son. She, you know, cleans his clothes. She's there for him. But is she there for him? So this is kind of the real question of the book. I mean, she does, I mean, from the outside seeing, she does all the right things. And I think we might all, you know, do the right things. But where is love in all these things? And how do we kind of really, how do we feel love inside these actions? What in these actions is love? I mean, where does it peep out the love in it?
Chiar dacă poate unele voci întreabă cum se descurcă o femeie singură aici, în spațiul
ăsta. Even though there are some voices that are wondering themselves, how does a woman manage to solve different problems here?
Am foarte multe prietene și foarte multe femei de pe site-ul unde care sunt își cresc copiii singure.
I have a lot of friends that are growing their children by themselves.
Au o carieră, un job.
They have a career, a job.
Multe din ele au și pasiuni care le au.
A lot of them have a lot of passions that take up a lot of time.
Și au creat un grup de suport ca să nu lipsească din viața
copilului. And they have created a support group so that they can't miss any moment from their children's life.
Și își iubesc foarte mult copiii.
And they love their kids very, very much.
Cred că dacă mutăm discuția către cât timp trebuie să petreci cu copilul tău ca să simtă cât de mult îl iubești.
I think if you have to put your finger on how much time does a woman need to spend with her child,
putem să stăm aici până la Crăciun.
We can stay here until Christmas.
Pentru că poți să definești foarte multe lucruri. Și am avut în 13 ani de când am unul de lucru în loc, nenumărate, poate că zeci, sute de discuții pe tema asta, cu bărbați și femei.
Because you can define this in so many different ways. So I've had a lot of discussions, both with women and male, about this subject, and...
Știu că în carte totul e tratat într-o extremă. Aveam eu sentimentul că aș vrea să intru în carte și să fiu mamă pentru băiat, că aveam sentimentul că se poate întâmpla ceva.
While reading this book, I was under the impression that I really wanted to enter the book and to be with the mother. Sorry.
It's okay. Cred că până la urmă dragostea ți-o manifesti în foarte multe feluri și o oferi în foarte multe feluri și copilul simte asta.
I think after all, you express love in so many ways and you act in so many ways in order to show this feeling.
And the kid feels it. Și cred că ce e foarte important este nu știu în câte țări mai e posibil astăzi ca mama să stea full time cu copilul acasă și nici nu cred că asta ar însemna că ea iubește 100% în toate felurile.
And what is really important, I don't really know in how many countries is a mother able to stay at home with her child and show her that he loves him. But I think after all, that's not even that important.
Pentru că dragostea pentru copilul tău o arăți în multe feluri, chiar și când nu ești el.
Because
așa se întâmplă și cu tine.
You can show your love in so many ways, even when your kid isn't there, and you can still show your love for him.
Altfel n-ar mai exista femei de carieră și mame în aceeași persoană.
Otherwise, there would be no business women, and you won't even have a job.
And be a mother at the same time.
I'm not a mother, but you have friends with kids.
I have a nephew who's 3, and it's for me. It's like il magia.
It's magic.
Juana is the absolute magic.
Oana este absolut magical.
Pentru că îmi pun aceleași întrebări.
Because I ask myself the same questions.
În legătură cu cât de multă atenție
necesară. To how much attention is it necessary?
Și nu numai despre cantitate, dar și despre cum anume arată atenția de calitate pe care o dai unui copil.
And it's not about the quantity of attention, it's about the mode in which it's expressed.
Quality.
It's the quality.
Și de ce spun că e magic? Pentru că...
Why do I say it's magic?
Neavând eu copii,
because even if I don't have a child,
cumva și aici, nu știu cum o să spune lucrul ăsta, dar experimentez cu Ana.
Somehow I experiment this with Ana.
Fel de a fi cu ea.
So many ways of being with her.
Și constat că, de fapt, ceea ce este un moment pentru mine, există anumite momente care sunt
That there are some moments that I can't even describe.
Pentru că ne
jucăm, because we play,
și aproape că nu vorbim,
and we almost don't even talk.
Dar e un fel de înțelegere și de armonie.
It's a way of understanding, of harmony.
Un soi de energie.
It's a sort of energy.
Și de atenție,
and extrem
de intensă.
Extremely intense.
Și ca și cum și ea și eu am și.
And it's like almost
ce simțim și ce credem și cum suntem și nu e nevoie să stai la trei ore.
We both know what we feel, what we want to say, and it's not necessary to talk for 3 hours. We just have to spend time together and get ourselves, understand ourselves.
Și n-are decât 3 ani.
And she's only 3 years old.
Așa că nu am niciun fel de competență să vorbesc despre cât timp trebuie să petreci cu copilul.
So I shouldn't say how much time is necessary to spend with a child.
Cum trebuie să te comporți sau cum trebuie să-i arăți anumite lucruri.
Or how you should act, or how you should show to him different things, I don't really know.
Ceea ce pot spune în experiența mea personală este că cred că contează foarte mult calitatea, intenția și ceea ce pui în acea interacțiune de bună.
But what I can really say from out of my experience is that it really matters the quality of the time you spend with a child.
Ce mi se pare mie important este...
What I find important is that
dacă vrei ca femeie,
but it's also common for men,
să poți să dai iubire,
so you can offer love,
trebuie să ai iubire pentru tine și să fii tu plină de iubire.
You have to love yourself and to be full of love.
Vorbei despre feminitate.
You are talking about femininity.
Și feminitatea se întâmplă din inimă, din ce
and
ce simți.
Femininity comes out of your heart, out of your feelings.
Și în momentul în care ești centrată pe tine și știi cine ești ca femeie,
and in that precise moment, when you know what you are as a woman,
cumva poți să-ți acoperi această sete de iubire.
Somehow you can cover that thirst of love.
Sau să-ți o împlinești fără...
Or to fulfill it without...
Fără ca propriul tău copil să sufere.
Without your child suffering.
Și cred că dacă pune problema cât timp petreci cu copilul, ar trebui să lucrezi sau nu.
And if you ask, if we ask ourselves the questions, how many hours should you spend with your child, if you should work or not?
Cred că pornim dintr-un sistem de referință greșit, dintr-un punct greșit.
I think we depart from not a right place.
Pentru că dacă ne-am întrebat cum să ne facem pe noi ca femei să fim conștiente de cine suntem și să fim iubire, să avem iubire.
Because if we were to make ourselves as women, to be able to know who you are as women, if we can give love,
și conștiente de feminitatea noastră,
and conscious of our femininity,
și să trăim din feminitatea noastră,
and to live out of our femininity,
atunci n-ar mai exista Vibeke și
there wouldn't be libecendio.
Relația lor.
Their relationship.
Problema.
Their problem.
Lipsa lor de iubire.
Their lack of love.
Your Excellency, your mother, and you're a public person, and you know about the social place of women in Norway, and I guess you know about the social place of women in Romania now. Is there any flagrant differences between the status of women in Norway and in Romania?
I think you have also touched upon it in the beginning, that you have been asked this question earlier today, would it be possible to be a single mother and a single mother in Norway? And for many, yes, it wouldn't be a question. I mean, there are ways of living, yes, as a single mother in Norway. With some, if you don't have a job or if you are still a student, get the child when you are still very young, there would be mechanisms in the society assisting you so that you can take care of your child because it's the responsibility of the society. So it's, I believe there is a major difference there, and the social welfare structure and system are making it possible to raise a child, and also access to schools, to kindergartens, independent of what is your own salary. That is a very important principle in the Norwegian society, that you have equal access, so it shouldn't be based on what you earn yourself. Making it possible, and Norway has a very high rate of women taking part in the labor force. And interestingly enough, we also have a higher birth rate than many other countries in Europe, for instance. So it actually goes hand in hand that it's made possible to raise children and to be a working mother, and meaning that more women get more children in Norway than in Europe.
I have a friend who lives in Norway. And he told me, he's a male friend, he told me that women there seem to be very strong, and they do many manly jobs. They are the technical domains. They are not afraid to enter the space of a man in the professional field.
Yeah, what shall I say? It's a harsh climate. It makes us tougher. No, but it has been, again, it's been a policy over years and years to create equal basis for women and men in Norwegian society. It doesn't mean that there are no differences, but making it possible for women, for girls to take any education and then to be qualified for the variety of jobs that also men have. So you will find maybe a greater variety within positions in Norway than in some, again, some other countries in Europe, yes. And the girls are raised to be strong in a way. I'll give one little example. When one of my girls, when she was 9 years old, and they were practicing before a play, school play in the school, and the teacher seemed to only be seeing the boys and giving them time to practice for this play. And then my daughter, it was an incident, coincidence that it was her, she mobilized the other girls and said, well, we'll protest, because we want as much time as the boys to practice for this play, for the Christmas program. And I think that is an illustration of many girls being, they learn it from an early age that their voice is as important as the voice.
Yeah. Back to the book, Vibeke is a very strong woman, and there is a moment here when
she criticized local architecture, and this town seems very small for her. She has high expectations for her, and maybe she felt that there is nowhere to breathe there. Was it hard to build Rebecca as a character? You gave her some of your thoughts?
You put yourself into all the characters, and you kind of, you know, and we are many people inside, I mean, we are many, each of us, so it's not that hard. Of course I did. I wrote her. Yes, she is. You said she's strong, but she's always also kind of, you know, vulnerable, because she's kind of, she has all this very, very dreams, these dreams, these kind of images of how things should be and how she wants them to be, and it's almost like she lives in her own fantasy, and she kind of sees what she kind of dreams she wants to see. She meets this man, Tom, who works at the fair, and he, you know, he's driving the UFO machine, and she goes with him in his little cabin wagon, because, you know, they're driving around, so he has his own cabin wagon, and he just offers her a coffee, but they're kind of, you know, they're barely inside the wagon before she kind of imagines them to be, you know, married, or, you know, really into a deep relationship. So she kind of, she's really kind of, you know, longing so much for someone to be close to her and love them, you know, all those. She has all these images. She sees them on the beach, and there's, you know, a boat, and she has all these kind of, you know, dreams. And I can identify with that. I mean, I guess we all can. I see you're smiling. I guess it's not that far away. So that was kind of, you know, writing about her was about, you know, taking out all those fantasies that we also have. Yes. When I wrote this book, I wrote it. I wrote the whole book before I knew the title, and I was, you know, wondering what title I should give it. But I knew only one thing, because the book, my second novel, the novel before this, the title of that book is Entropy. How is that said in English? Entropy. And that's a figure. Yeah, so that's a concept from, you know, the physics, the microphysics of this, you know, when energy is in a closed container, it goes towards dissimulation. It kind of, and so that's a very precise term for that process in physics, and that state. And I wrote the book and I called it Entropy, and there were, you know, so many people that said, oh, I really don't, I couldn't even bother to read your book because I couldn't understand your title. And so when I wrote this book, I thought that the title, it should be so, you know, accessible. It should be, you know, the most accessible possible. And then it's love. But then I really must say that it is intriguing, because I think this word is so much harder to define, isn't it? And in the interviews today also, the journalist has asked me, you know, what is love? and now I ask you, I mean, please, feel free. Somebody has, you know, a wonderful definition, jump forward. So it would be, yes, what is love, actually? You know.
Yeah.
Woo!
A propos de definiție, Emilia.
Love.
Acum un an de zile am auzit o poveste care ne-a definit ceea ce n-am crezut că cineva poate să îndeplinească vreodată, respectiv iubirea.
Almost a year ago I heard a story that helped me get to the definition of love.
Un bărbat și o femeie,
a man and a woman,
au stat timp de 18 ani
lived together for 18 years.
Au lucrat în vârf de muntă la o stație meteo în România.
They worked on a mountain at a meteorological station in Romania.
Erau soț și soție.
They were husband and wife.
Și aveau un copil. Asta se întâmpla când ei aveau în jur de peste 50 de ani. Aveau un copil pe care l-au lăsat în oraș, la școală.
And they had a child, and that happened when they both were 50 years old, and they left the child in the city at school.
Și l-a adus la ei doar în weekend de către bunici.
And the child only spent the weekends with them because his grandparents brought him to them.
Și după 18 ani, când și-au terminat misiunea,
and after 18 years old, after they finished their mission,
au coborât și au reluat viața urbană.
They went down and relived their urban life.
Și majoritatea oamenilor cu care se întâlneau îi întreba, ok, cum ați rezistat singuri în vârf de munte timp de 18 ani?
And everybody back in the city asked them, how did you live there for 18 years?
Uitând la jurul nostru și văzând cupluri care nu rezistă mai mult de câteva luni, mai mult, hai, câțiva ani.
Looking around and seeing that there are couples that only can only live for a couple of months, maybe a year.
Iar ei au stat singuri în vârf de munte 18 ani.
And they've been together for 18 years.
Și răspunsul lor a fost, și aici vine definiția iubirii.
And their answer was, and here comes the definition of love.
Contează scopul pe care îl avem unul împreună cu celălalt, iar scopul nostru este să ne mântuim împreună.
What really matters is the goal that we have set together, and our goal is to to save each other.
Pentru mine a fost definiția maximă. Când cei doi trăiesc împreună, nu unul pe lângă celălalt, nu unul alături de celălalt, ci trăiesc real împreună.
For me, that was the best definition. Love is when you live together with that person and not next to them. You are really living.
Vorbim de relația dintre două persoane și când ne ducem cu iubirea într-o altă definiție metafizică, teologică sau...
What I'm talking about is about love between two persons, not a metaphysical love or a theological perception.
Okay, I think you can find as many definitions and explanations as at least there are people in the room and much more. But going back to the book, I read a book, and you can look forward to reading it. And you mentioned, you commented saying that there is a hole somewhere. The mother is longing for attention and love. But what I think you describe so intensively is the linkage between love and trust. The boy is really driven by trust. He is loving his mother so much, and he trusts that he knows all the time what she is up to, without saying the story, but that he has total trust in his mother, and thereby also total love, which maybe it's not what you will experience, but still, it's a very, very, it really touches you when you read it, the fate the boy shows towards his mother.
Am putut să mă pun în pielea mamei, personajului, cu toate cele două planuri, cu toate fanteziile și aspirațiile și dorințele și nevoia de a trăi o anumită poveste.
The thing I could say is that I could really empathize with that woman. I could feel her needs, I could imagine her fantasies.
Și în același timp am simțit cumva planul real și nevoia cumva divergentă de a fi, de a trăi acea fantezie, de a trăi acel gen de viață și de a fi în planul real în același timp. Și cred că nu-mi dau seama, dar din...
And I also had this feel of reality, and at the same time, I wanted to live the character's fantasies.
Și ceea ce cred și am descoperit vorbind cu prietenele mele, cu oameni pe care îi cunosc, este că toți avem această, aceste, toți avem aceste planuri paralele în care trăim.
And what I have discovered by talking with some of my friends and acquaintances is that we both have this, we all have this duality. We both live in a real plan and at the same time in our fantasy world. At least from time to time, or else we'll tend to go mad and forget about things.
Deci ca să mă întorc la întrebarea despre personajul din carte, eu am putut simți foarte bine această, acest paralelism, știu să numesc. Văzând același lucru și citind același lucru și fiind în același loc, fiecare dintre noi am altă poveste. We read the same book, we are in the same place, we see the same movie, but we have a different story about it. Și cred că, de fapt, dacă ne întoarcem la discuția despre copii și femei și societate și are ea grijă de copil sau nu are ea grijă de copil, trebuie să-i dai mai mult timp sau mai puțin din de calitate, e mai bine așa sau mai nimic. Suntem în această conversație în care cu toții avem o realitate și fiecare o interpretează după o lentilă foarte personală. Și întorcându-ne la ideea de iubire și la, la ideea de iubire, cred că pentru mine întrebarea esențială este dacă am eu capacitatea ca știind acest lucru să pot să integrez lumea celuilalt fără să încerc să-i schimb.
Man 2.0 is the man that knows who he is and he's not afraid of the woman 2.0.
Yeah.
And we have, well, that then 2.1. We are always in beta version if you think like that, because we always want to improve, so we are never done. So that's a good thing. You can shoot me, I'm still optimistic. But I think actually, that is the beauty of what's going on with all this crazy, crazy economy, crazy geography, crazy politics. People go more inwards and you dig old books out and they are so actual because it's about looking upon ourselves and about living fuller and loving. You gave a definition of love, which is beautiful, but there is also self-love. There are so many ways of loving. And I actually believe that when both women and men know who they are, and they are not afraid of whom they are in connection with the other one, that's when we're going to live in a great relationship and harmony. And I know it sounds ridiculously optimistic and totally idealistic, but this is what we all tend to go towards when we, I don't know, go to courses, go to yoga, run on the track, or do things that make us closer to who we are and to listen to our heart. This love thing, you're right, Chris, we use it, Jesus, we don't even remember what it means many times, but it's all about it. And if you read quantum physics, that's the most powerful energy in the world. So going back to that, I think the man 2.1, see, I missed the step, is the man that knows who he is. He's not afraid to love and to be vulnerable, and he's not afraid of the woman, whatever, wherever she is, 1.2, 1.18, 2.2, because at the end of the world, at the end of the day, it's just about being able to communicate. And I'll tell you something. That feeling that you have when you are in love is the feeling when you shut down your mind and you just give with your heart. And that's about it, because that's when it works. And you don't ask, do you get it or am I getting it? You just leave it. Man, was that a good answer or what?
Ground.